to those veterans who have been harmed for their healing. We also pray for those who are presently serving both here at home and overseas. We thank them for their ongoing service to us. We pray that they will return to their families safely. We may not live in a perfect world, but I remind all of us here that as we pledge allegiance to the American flag, we should always remember those who stood and those who presently stand behind that flag. Last week was also an election. No matter which side everyone stands on, we pray that the transition to a new administration goes smoothly and that the new administration will govern in the interest of all. On to the work before us tonight and all other nights. We once again pray for wisdom, knowledge, and understanding of the issues we are to face here tonight and all the other nights we are to meet here. We pray for tolerance and respect. We ask for this for those whose thoughts and opinions we disagree with, and for those who disagree with our own opinions and thoughts. We should always build bridges of understanding and not walls against it. We are here to determine what is best for the citizens of the town and those who are affected beyond our borders. We pray for a clear picture of the issues. In that way, we can apply the wisdom, the knowledge, and understanding each of us gain to the decisions we make here. As I have done in the past, I remind all of us that we should all consider ourselves as friends. My friends, some ignore what we do here. Some just plain don't care. Some consider it non-critical. But every time we come here to this hall, each of us, and all of us collectively, should set aside the naysayers and try for just and fair decisions that benefit all. After going forward, after these decisions from this hall, we should try to facilitate those decisions and to avoid any strategies to divert us from those decisions. And then with patience, some sacrifice, perseverance, and a little of God's grace, there should be positive results for our decisions. Praise the Lord. God bless America. Amen.
Now the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. The clerk will now read the warrant.
To any and all of the constables of the town of Reading, greetings. In the name of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, you are hereby required to notify and warn all the inhabitants of the town of Reading qualified to vote in town elections and town affairs to meet at the Reading High School Performing Arts Center, 62 Oakland Road in said Reading on Monday, November 14, 2016 at 7:30 o'clock in the evening, at which time and place the following articles are to be acted upon and determined exclusively by the town of Reading town meeting members in accordance with the provisions of the Reading Home Rule Charter.
Mr. Halsey moves that we dispense with the further reading of the warrant with the exception of the officer's return. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, motion carries.
By virtue of this warrant, I, on September 28, 2016, notified and warned the inhabitants of the town of Reading qualified to vote in town elections and town affairs to meet at a place and at the time specified by posting attested copies of the town meeting warrant in the following public places within the town of Reading. Precinct 1, Warren Killam School. Precinct 2, Reading Police Station. Precinct 3, Reading Municipal Light Department. Precinct 4, Joshua Eaton School. Precinct 5, Walter S. Parker Middle School. Precinct 6, Barrow School. Precinct 7, Birch Meadow School. Precinct 8, Wood End School, and Town Hall. The date of posting being not less than 14 days prior to November 14, 2016, the date set for the town meeting in this warrant. I also caused a posting of the warrant to be published on the Town of Reading website on September 28, 2016.
I have just one announcement. Over the next few weeks, we have a lot to get through, and it's at times it's going to get confusing. Before us are three separate town meetings. The first is the subsequent town meeting, our normal November meeting. Because we have so many zoning articles, we expect it will take a lot of time. Mixed in are two separate special town meetings. One is scheduled for tonight, and the other is set for next Monday. The first deals with litigation and the second with liquor licenses. The town clerk has reserved the hall for several nights. We intend to schedule sessions in the following manner. Tonight, we open the subsequent meeting, go through about Article 3, then we'll temporarily adjourn it so we can open the posted first special meeting. Since the relevant information is not yet ready, there will be an adjournment until next Monday, and then we'll immediately go back into the subsequent meeting. The next planned session is for this Thursday, November 7th. We'll begin with the state of the schools and then continue with the November subsequent meeting. Next Monday, we'll convene the second special meeting and continue until its completion. Then we'll open the first special meeting, we'll continue that until completion, and if there's time, we'll convene the subsequent meeting and work on that. If it's too late, we'll convene it, then immediately adjourn it. Then we skip the following Thursday, Thanksgiving, and reconvene again Monday, November 28th. If needed, the rest of the schedule is as follows. Thursday, December 1st, Monday, December 5th, Thursday the 8th, Monday the 12th. We skip the 15th, I believe the hall is not available. Monday the 19th, and then Thursday the 22nd. And with that, we will start. Is there business under Article 1, Ms. O'Brien? Oh, Mr. O'Rourke? Okay.
Tom O'Rourke, Precinct 2. Good evening, town meeting members. As chairman of the Board of Commissioners for the Reading Municipal Light Department, I have the opportunity and privilege to introduce in a moment our general manager for the Reading Municipal Light Department, Colleen O'Brien. Colleen is the general manager since 2013, and during that time has demonstrated a strong passion for continuous improvement and reliability. She's recognized as a consummate professional, engineer, and general manager in the municipal power generating communities. Under her leadership, Reading Municipal Light Department continues to provide reliable, cost-effective power to the residential and commercial customers of its served communities. Her focus areas of success include renewable energy programs, reducing peak demand for financial benefits to the town, proactive approach in addressing long and short-term maintenance costs, and an organizational-wide implementation of career development plans, employee skills development, and succession planning. She is also a strong advocate for the use of technology and social media to improve communications and improve organizational and operational effectiveness. I'd like to now introduce Colleen O'Brien.
I'm grateful for you providing me an opportunity to give you an update on the Reading Municipal Light Department, your locally owned and operated municipal plant, one of 41 in the state of Massachusetts and the largest. I'm going to read a couple of things. I have a short presentation with some slides. Most of the information that I'm going to discuss, whether it's in the annual report or whether it's in my slides, can be found on our website, www.rmld.com. So if you want to see the details and specifics, you can go to those pages. But the Reading Municipal Light Plant has made significant progress over the last year in meeting its goals to reorganize, increase efficiency measures, reduce peak demand, improve employee skill sets, address reliability, and a short and long-term maintenance and system capacity issues. The electric industry remains volatile while the New England area rates continue to rise due to capacity and transmission costs. The region has also made a major move towards embracing renewables, including solar. While the RMLD has positioned itself to capture the benefits of the renewables for its customers, for example, RMLD's new Community Solar Choice Program, the RMLD must at the same time focus on mitigating revenue impacts that the renewables may pose as a competition to electric sales. Solar, for example, can be a challenge for the enterprise side of RMLD, as well as how it impacts the physical balancing and safety of the electrical system grid itself. To reemphasize our continued efforts over the last year, the RMLD remains in a transition phase from reactive to proactive. A quality electric utility must have the ability to be proactive in all of its disciplines, including planning, system function and operation, staffing, succession, and skill training. It must have the ability to be reactive through planned reaction procedures to unforeseen events such as weather and power market volatility. It must be diligent in ensuring that its plans and strategies are reviewed at such a frequency as to ensure that the utility stays aligned with the path of success. The RMLD staff has continued to work hard to review, develop, and implement all of the necessary actions to ensure a high level of quality. The focus of peak reduction remains one of the key factors in rate cost savings. Shaving our peak usage during peak periods, typically during hot summer months, has intensified. The savings associated with the shaving of just 1 megawatt during peak hours is now worth more than double it was last year. So this year, 1 megawatt was equivalent to $200,000. Communication efforts, including our new Twitter account and a whole host of RMLD programs, now target peak reductions. In fact, our school educational piece will now focus on the benefits of shaving the peak with a new and more hip motto of shred the peak. See up there? Shredding off the peak with the, got skateboarders in the audience? Kids? Okay. Yeah, there you go. The institutions of higher education have long been known for their ability to implement change management through the education of our children up to the parents. For example, let's take recycling. Our schools have made excellent headway in changing the way our children and we as adults look at waste, its cost, and its overall impact to our environment. Recycling is now a common household term. The RMLD wants to utilize the same strategies from the ground up to educate about the value of conservation, especially during peak demand times when the price of electricity is at its highest and when most of the most inefficient and environmentally polluting generators are called in for action. Our cover art depicts skateboarders shredding the peak. Looking forward, the RMLD will be changing its t-shirt contest to an art contest on this theme. The artwork will be displayed in RMLD using recycling framing. We would look to introduce a similar contest into the high school art program as well, using a blend of mixed media like photography to depict similar conservation and peak reduction aspects. Join us in our continued efforts to get greener, be efficient, go paperless, and shred the peak. The RMLD is committed to continuing to provide excellent customer service, including competitively priced electricity, as a result of diligence in the areas of power supply, risk management, system reliability and flexibility, as well as overall business efficiency. This slide just shows some of our FY 2016 statistics. This can be found, as again, on the website if you're into the number of poles we have, meter installations, et cetera. Okay, it's not moving. I've listed some peak performance highlights that we can discuss briefly. I've updated the RMLD terms and conditions. That's the terms and conditions of each person's homeowner or business's service of electricity. It's worth taking a look at on the website. It is a filed document. We've brought all of our policies and things of that nature that are filed up to code and in accordance with the new laws. We also created what's called a comprehensive RMLD service requirements handbook. It's quite thick, but it takes you from soup to nuts on everything you can possibly think about electricity, and it doesn't matter if you're a homeowner, an electrician, a developer, a builder, you want to paint the side of your house, you want us to come down and put hard gut or rubber up while you're painting your house, you can just search in that terms and condition. It tells you how to go about it, how long you can borrow it for. You can think of anything to do with electric service, go in and find, and you'll have all of your answers right there. It's a wonderful handbook, and it helps to promote communication, whether internally, of getting all the RMLD employees on the same page, as well as all of our customers. This year, we just finished up a clean audit with no management letter. We developed a new solar choice program. I'll have another slide on that. That's very interesting. Comprehensive short and long-term recommendations from our organizational and reliability study. All safety-related reliability recommendations were implemented immediately. Organizational structure, we have draft reorganizational charts, and we're moving along to redo all of the job description and, as Tom mentioned, career development plans so that we can ensure the best skill sets to meet the best utility practices. Our grid modernization technology roadmap was completed. We might see Davies contractors coming around and collecting GIS data, which we're building. We are building an AMI mesh network so that we can collect more data from some of our larger customers. Peak reduction programs and maintaining reliability indices within the regional and national averages. LED streetlight fixtures, I have another slide on them. I can let you know how we're doing in each town. The internal and external communications, including our new Twitter account that you can follow, where we post area outages and estimated time of restorations. We also have an app for your cell phone that you can report outages on the app. We also will use the Twitter to notify people of the ISO grid. The ISO kind of handles the whole system grid in New England. And if they're having a power warning or any type of power issues, we'll also use Twitter for that as well. We've done a significant amount of maintenance. I have a slide on that. Let's move on. Efficiency and peak reduction measures. Our rebate structures, all of our rebates that you can find on the website, are all based on that amount of megawatts that we reduce during that peak. Everything is based off of that analysis. But we have commercial programs for rebates, lightings, electrical vehicle charging stations if people are starting to buy electrical vehicles, peak demand reduction programs with customers that have generators that are willing to curtail their load to save energy during peak. We have the online store. We don't sell the holiday lights on the online store, but if you wanted to come into RMLD, we do sell the holiday lights, and they're LEDs, and they're wonderful. They're not bright white. They're actually kind of a yellow, and they look really nice on the trees. So if you're interested in that, everything there is sold at about 50% off of what you would see at a retail store. Residential energy audits, and this year we have finished designing and we're getting ready to install a 2.5 megawatt generating peak shedder in North Reading at one of our substations, which will have a payback of less than 5 years, and then post of that save about $600,000 a year when we hit that peak button during peak shedding. This is our solar choice program. We are going to each of the towns, and we're working with developers and the towns to come up with solar projects. We used to have a green choice, where if you were interested in part of your electric bill being provided by green energy, we now do that in our service territory. So our first pilot is a 1 megawatt solar rooftop unit at Ballardville Street in Wilmington, but it's open to everyone in the service territory. Unfortunately, like a good concert, it's all sold out. So we had 500 customers sign up for that, and so we're on to the next project, and it is our intention to keep going with as many solar rooftop units or canopies that we can, so that everyone can participate in this great new program. If you are really interested in this and want to get on the waiting list or want more details, you're welcome to call Jane Parento in Integrated Resources, and we can go over the details with you. Economic development. We do have some economic development pockets in the Reading area. We have some other pockets in North Reading, in Wilmington. We are always interested in getting more customers, and these are some of the types of incentives and benefits that we convey to potential customers. It is this list that was actually allowed us to bring Osram Sylvania into Wilmington, and that was a great victory to bring them here. And they had a lot of other communities that they were looking at, but Reading Light and our low rates and our great rebate programs is what helped to bring that type of economic development. These are our 10 new proactive maintenance programs. We are pretty aggressive at making sure that the system stays safe and reliable. These are our annual reliability indices. I think you can try to make them a little bit bigger. Essentially, it's based on how many outages, how many people are out. There's three different types of calculations. Sadie, Kafee, and Katie are all industry-wide throughout the nation. And Reading Municipal Light falls well within the regional and national averages for their outage statistics. The causes of the outage are at 36% equipment. It's not necessarily equipment failing, but it might be an integral fuse that's melting or blowing, and that's really what equipment is the type of equipment that's failing. Trees are still at 30%. We have an aggressive tree program that we work with the tree warden here in Reading. It seems to be going well. Wildlife at 21%, and then the balance. So we work very difficult. Actually, wildlife was a lot higher several years ago, and we had a program to put animal guards. Believe it or not, squirrels, hawks are a major reason why there's a lot of outages. The distance between their nose and their tail or their wingspan would touch a hot and neutral and cause an outage. The LED streetlight program, we received a grant probably about a year and a half ago for $250,000, of which $125,000 went towards LED lights in all four communities. The other $125,000 went for LEDs for commercial and residential upgrades through rebates. We finished the pilot program in FY15 with 300 lights. Everyone was happy, so we continued. And so right now, out of approximately 8,000 lights, we are about halfway done. In here, you'll see Reading FY16, 961, and FY17 year-to-date, another 307. So I'm hoping that I know the police love them, with the sharpness of the lights, and hopefully everyone is happy with them. Engines is a joint ownership type of program that we use when we transfer poles, when you're looking at double poles. I know that they're an eyesore. We're pretty aggressive in doing pole inspections, so a lot more poles are being changed out than probably in the past, and that's a good thing for reliability and safety. On the other hand, the aesthetics of them, you want them set, transferred, and out of there. So engines is a brand new program where all the attachers, meaning cable TV, fire, electric, each person is notified by this new engines program that says, okay guys, the ball is in your court, time to transfer. And the sooner we can get all the transfers done, then we can get the poles out of there. So I just wanted you to know that we do care about the double poles. We know that they can be an eyesore, and we're working as diligently as we can to remove them. And that's all I have. Thank you, and don't forget to shred the peak.
Thank you. Mr. Halsey moves that we lay Article 1 on the table. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor? All those opposed? Motion carries. Business under Article 2. Mr. Halsey moves that we lay the substance of Article 2 on the table. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? Motion carries. Business under Article 3. Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Town meeting members, in September's special town meeting did most of the heavy lifting for capital. but there are some relatively minor changes suggested for November, and there will be some more that are already enlisted for April. There's one item shown in green behind me, and by the way, if you didn't get a list of the motions, they're very heavy, about a 29-pound document that's in the back. It's 60-some-odd pages, and it's a lot of what was in the warrant report, but it's updated. So there are a few things, such as Article 3, that have changed since the warrant report was printed. And one example is this $50,000 request for a sidewalk plow. But it's important that you pick up those motions, because it also, later in town meeting, is going to have some suggested changes, as by CPDC and the bylaw committee, for some of the bylaws. So behind me again, Article 3 does not fund anything. It just puts things in a capital plan, and different from your warrant report, there was a piece of equipment that DPW owned that was purchased for between $130,000 and $40,000 that is defective. It is out of warranty, but we did get a reasonably good trade-in, and under Article 4, we'll ask you to declare the old unit as $80,000 worth of surplus, and for $50,000 worth of net capital, we'll be able to purchase a new one. So that specifically in FY17, there's now a plus $14,000 change to capital, with the $50,000 item I just listed swinging that around from a negative number. We moved up $30,000 of a scanner plotter that has broken in engineering from 1 year forward. We're requesting to add $19,000 to a school van, so it's now $55,000. We're requesting to add $15,000 to a West Side fire roof, so that it's now $90,000. And that was scheduled to be worked on next April, but it's much better if we can get that project going now. And lastly, with a joint meeting between the Board of Selectmen, the Finance Committee, the Board of Cemetery Trustees, and the Permanent Building Committee, the $200,000 total available funding to the Permanent Building Committee was suggested to be cut in half and reduced this $100,000. So that design work on a new cemetery building was not completed. It was just more exploratory work on other sites other than the cemeteries themselves. And then there are some changes, as you can see, to FY18. In water and sewer, there's a net zero change in water, but I felt obliged to show it. $300,000 increase in capital. There'll be a $300,000 decrease in debt. You can see some of the components shown behind me. I believe that's all for Article 3.
FinCom report, Mr. Leidecker.
At our earlier meeting tonight, the Finance Committee recommended the proposed amendments to the fiscal year 2017 to 2027 capital improvements program by a vote of 9-0, and placing the items in the capital improvement program is a prerequisite, but is in itself does not authorize spending funds towards these items.
Is there further discussion? And appearing, and we're ready for the vote. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, and the motion carries. Okay, here's where it gets a little tricky. We're going to have to temporarily stop the subsequent meeting and then call what I'm going to call special number one into order, but then close it almost immediately. So Mr. Halsey moves that we temporarily adjourn the subsequent meeting until a few minutes from now. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed. Motion carries. The subsequent town meeting is temporarily adjourned. A quorum being present, I now call the special town meeting to order. Is there any explanation, or are we just ready to move on? Mr. Lasher?
I can give one. Town meeting, the superintendent and the school committee is not fully prepared with a signed agreement to produce tonight, and would prefer to delay this 1 week to next Monday.
Mr. Halsey moves that we adjourn the special town meeting until Monday, November 21st. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, motion carries. The special town meeting stands adjourned. I now call the subsequent meeting back to order. Is there business under Article 4? Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. This article is to dispose of surplus equipment, and you can see, as I just mentioned, there's one change from the warrant report that should be shown in the motion. There's that $80,000 item for surplusing the old sidewalk plow that's defective. Otherwise, most of this is trade-in, but there's a couple of auction items. I suggest you bid on them.
At our meeting tonight, November 14, 2016, the Finance Committee recommend the subject matter of this article by a vote of 9-0-0.
Is there further discussion? None appearing. Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, the motion carries. Business under Article 5, Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I should warn you that I could spend an hour talking about this one, and it's not that interesting. So, the town meeting has done this before. Previously in 2015, when the town sold the first piece of debt for the library project, it was sold at a premium price. That just means that whoever's buying it at above 100 cents in the dollar is only going to get 100 cents back on the dollar at maturity. But they're willing to buy some cash flow up front and take that loss. If you think about it, if we sold $1 million worth of par value library debt and we received $1,200,000 for it, we've effectively circumvented Prop 2.5. So all this does is bring that back into line and ask town meeting to reduce the authorization for debt so that it can account for the premium that we received and not allow us to sneakily go out and borrow more money. That's it in a nutshell.
FinCom report, Ms. Alvarado.
At the meeting on October 4th, 2016, the Finance Committee recommends the subject matter of this article by a vote of 8-0-0. This article is a financial technical correction only and is required by the auditors.
Further discussion? Yes, Mr. Lloyd.
I didn't make it clear enough. This is only because of this excluded debt outside the levy for the library. The rest of the debt, the premium, is not a financial issue. It's just we may have circumvented the will of the voters, technically, if we don't do this.
Further discussion? Not appearing. Are we all set for the vote? Those in favor, please raise your hand. And those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 6, Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Town meeting is requested to take this authorized debt off the books. These are two projects. We try to, you know, wait some time and gather up more, but there really aren't any more forthcoming. So this was debt that was authorized and never issued because we knew it was not needed. However, it's the authorization you gave is still on the books, and we'd like to clean that up, and so would the auditors. We have no need to borrow any further money on these two projects.
FinCom report, Ms. Landry.
At our meeting on October 4th, 2016, the Finance Committee recommended the subject matter of this article by a vote of 8-0-0. This article is a financial cleanup only and is suggested by the auditors.
Further discussion? None appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 7, Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. This is also a technical financial issue, but I think I'm going to need to do some explaining. Every so often, we aggregate past issued debt that we did not need to complete a project, and you can see there's four amounts behind me. The two oldest ones, $7,700 and $5, we knew we had, but we again try to aggregate them. And in 2005, two other projects were completed with surpluses of $130,000. So those four projects have already issued that debt. We're obliged to repay the debt. We're also obliged to use the debt with certain DOR regulations on what we can and can't use it for. I'm asking town meeting, and I'll explain why, to transfer this $141,000 of already existing debt to the library project. And just to be clear, that will mean that this $141,000 is paid inside the levy, not outside the levy. And it's existing debt that's already been budgeted for and paid for, if you will, or it's in the process of being paid for. That would move up the project from, you can see it's 18.4 million to almost not quite 1% more. Just for town meeting members that may not have been around, there's a quick timeline behind me. September 2008, there was a building assessment and that kicked off the process. You can see some other important dates. July 2009, the trustees presented, I think it was 5 options, including building on the site or building on other sites, and had an ongoing dialogue with the community for a couple years. In 2011, the town was awarded funds, but not funded, $5 million and change, and then in 2012, with a lot of help from our legislators, that was funded. 2013, an owner's project manager and then an architect were hired, and off we went. Town meeting had previously approved $75,000 in 2010 for a design study, and I'm going to come back to that. A $14.9 million project in 2013, and you can see that we had an OPM and an architect on board, and that's when it became clear that the prior estimate was not sufficient, and another $3.5 million was requested and approved by town meeting. And both of these projects went to the voters in 2 consecutive local elections in April 2013 and 14 and were approved. The first thing I want to talk to you about is building committees. In this case, there's a library building committee. It was originally comprised of two trustees, 2 library appointees, and 3 members from the community. One of those library appointees was changed a year or so ago to a town manager appointee. In contrast, we now have a permanent building committee that was authorized through this body. There's 5 members of the community instead of 3. They're a majority of the committee. And then there's 2 additional members from a sponsoring agency, such as library, schools, town. And depending on the requirements, for instance, MSBA has very specific requirements of what a building committee must look like. The permanent building committee may have 9 members total, but there will always be a majority from the community, 5 members. The revised structure of the permanent building committee is very important. They will appear, I think, before you in April with a request to revise the bylaw and some reasons. But the focus has, you know, certainly been sharpened on construction expertise, and you can see the list of the 5 permanent building committee members' fields, plus the 2 associate members' fields, and they're all very related to the construction business. They all work in that business one way or the other. They have devised an extremely thorough and formal application process, and by that I mean if any one of the elected boards wants to propose a new building, they have to go through a very rigorous process. They are very independent from the sponsoring agency. As you can see, they have a majority and they also have professional expertise. So I think that the permanent building committee is an excellent structure and will perhaps sidestep some of the issues that I'll get to in the future on the library project and others. In terms of finances, the trustees approved the site design, the site and final design. The library building committee then did approve many of the, I'll call, interior design elements, and particularly this was so as it related directly to library programs. The owner's project manager, the facilities director, and myself had an early focus on things outside the building and securing the building itself, the building envelope especially. As the budget started to come into play, we took a stronger hand in the other issues. The 2 primary issues that we ran into that we did not foresee, but maybe could have been foreseen, were site conditions. There was extensive ledge in the rear parking lot. Anyone who lives nearby heard the hammering knows about that. We finally gave up and had to redesign the whole drainage system at quite an expensive cost. And then the actual building conditions, as demolition occurred, it was very clear that previous work done was very poor. It was all work that could not be seen, and it was work that no one was able to proof. You know, whether it was done with a good project manager, it was certainly not done with terrific oversight. The solutions to some of these, to these 2 major unexpected conditions were twofold. One is a lot of people chipped in with funding. We did one project, at least, or one portion of the project that was not anticipated to be part of the project. That was the Deering Street retaining wall. The project had repair money for it. It was in such poor shape it had to be rebuilt. It seems senseless to repair it as part of the project and then rebuild it in 3 years, so we rebuilt it then and there. So that was a cost that perhaps was rightly not foreseen in the project. But many other costs were borne by different town departments, by the library trustees themselves with the big state aid budget, and you know, some of the town and technology staff as well. We could have easily along the way, brought this project in under budget by violating that challenge number two and looked the other way on quality issues, and it wouldn't have taken much. When you see the figure I'm going to tell you we need, it's not that much. But we were very adamant that we were not going to skimp on quality and not skimp on construction. And just to give a quick example, anyone who knows that when the moon was full, the basement would flood, we know why. We actually waterproofed it three different ways. Any one was probably enough. Two surely would have been enough. We did three. If that thing floods, I'll eat my hat. I've eaten it before, I might add. Here are, I think, is perhaps for town meeting, an important slide. These are the lessons we believe we've learned. A formal application process, as designed by the Permanent Building Committee, will be an excellent gatekeeper. An annual review by town meeting, as is required in the bylaw with the Permanent Building Committee, will allow all of you to better understand all the building projects that are on the horizon and to have some voice in prioritizing them. Clearly, a mistake in the library project was more early discussion and early funding should have happened. I mentioned the $75,000. That's not very much to spend on an $18 million project up front. Should there have been a wider discussion about alternative approaches? Probably. There certainly should have been better funding to get some of the estimates right. Surely more drilling in the parking lot would have revealed that ledge. It just so happened that the site work was done did not find the ledge. It's a little harder to say how much drilling in the walls could have revealed the poor quality, because again, much of that was unseen. More thorough really work on the project, I think, is probably the most important lesson learned, is number six. I'm sure there will be things that go wrong with that building. They always do. But I really honestly don't believe anyone is going to ever look at that building and say they should have done it this way, they cut a corner, because we did not cut that corner. The library project punch list should be completed in early 2017. There are two articles in front of town meeting today, one to move $140,000 over to the project, one to ask for an unspecified amount. We will not need that unspecified amount. We will indefinitely postpone that article. This project will be brought in within the $140,000. The last update I got suggested perhaps around $50,000 was needed. But I can't promise that, because as any of you know who have done construction, a lot of bills appear at the last minute. So we are dedicated to do our best to build a building that the town will be proud of and one that will last for a long time. And I'm fully confident with all the information I have now that this $140,000 will complete the job.
FinCom report, Mr. Nishet.
At their meeting on October 4, 2016, the Finance Committee recommended the subject matter of this article by a vote of 800.
Is there further discussion? Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Murray. Bill Brown, Precinct 8. Is this $140,000 going to fix the 17 cracks in the new wall? You knew I'd ask that, Bob.
No, I forgot, actually. I'm told that either 15 or 16 of those cracks are designed that way. One was not, or maybe two. So what Mr. Brown is talking about is one of the retaining walls, and it was designed to breathe so that when it would change temperatures, it would not just fall over. And Mr. Brown has accurately found a couple of cracks that are unintended and should be repaired, and may well have been by now, I don't know. Do you know, Joe? Okay, so they haven't been repaired yet, but we are confident that the majority of those cracks were designed that way.
Well, I respectfully disagree with the engineers, but that's all right.
Yep.
Further discussion? Yes.
Megan Young, Precinct 4. Bob, thanks for the overview. I was just going to ask you about the lights. I know that was a problem with the residents, and I'd seen in the paper, so can you give us an update on the lighting situation?
The lights were pretty impressive. I had a friend that lived several blocks away that could see them. That's when I knew we had a problem. There's no question that the lights are an issue. What some of the neighbors perhaps rightly had some impatience over is, legally, the town could not step into a construction project as it was being managed by the contractor. When it was finally turned over to the town, then we finally could take action. So there is a solution. The neighbors have all been, on that side of our library, the neighbors have all been out with the facilities director and the assistant facilities director over here. They have together worked on a solution they are happy with. It'll still be some time for that solution to be put up, but I believe it cures the problem. We put this project through full site plan review, which is not required. Towns are exempt. I don't like that. The architect at the time made promises about the lights that they did not deliver in construction. Whoever fault it is doesn't matter. We are supposed to be able to dim the lights. They're either on or they're off. They are not dimmable unless you shoot one of them out, as some people have offered to do. But we have a solution, again, designed by the engineers. I believe there were four different attempts at corrections that were shown to them all at once so they could compare on five different lights. They all liked one of them. It's in progress.
Further discussion?
And that is part of the cost that probably the town will bear, just to be clear.
Further discussion? None appearing. This requires a two-thirds vote. We will try a hand count. If it is not unanimous, we will take a standing count. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion... Was there an opposition? Okay, we will take a standing count. Mr. Brown, would you take the right and the Finance Committee? Mr. Crook, would you take the right center? Mr. Rushworth, the left center? And Ms. Russell? Yes, okay, would you take the left and the Board of Selectmen? All those in favor, please rise. Thirty-six. All those opposed?
Zero.
Zero.
Two.
Two.
Three.
Three. The vote being 130 in the affirmative and 5 in the negative, the motion carries. Business under Article 8, Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. This is the same idea, but it's the Water Enterprise Fund. You can see behind us, there's three very old items. We kept waiting for more. It's finally time to do some housekeeping. There's a total of almost $70,000 in debt that was sold that was not needed to complete the work. And the irony is kind of nice that we first designed a new treatment plant and then demolished the old one and never built anything, of course. But there's $70,000 that we would like this body to request to move it as existing debt. And again, this has already been issued. It's being paid in the capital plan. To the generic water main projects that town meeting previously approved a couple years ago. The first I'm sure you saw on Salem Street when it was very hard to drive down it. And we'll also come back in the spring and ask for another $665,000 so that between the $665,000 and the $70,000, what was imagined to be done for the first legs of this water main project will be complete. And if for some reason we have overestimated the cost, as we do sometimes, a future town meeting will be asked to use that excess in the way we're dealing with it tonight.
FinCom report, Mr. Doxer.
Thank moderator. At our meeting on October 4th, 2016, the Finance Committee voted to recommend the subject matter of this article by a vote of 8-0-0.
Further discussion? None appearing. Are we ready for the vote? This again requires a two-thirds vote. We will try a hand count first. All those in favor, please raise your hand. And those opposed? And the motion carries unanimously. Business under Article 9, Mr. LaLasha.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. This is one that I owe an apology for. It's another technical issue with money. Town meeting previously authorized in April 2015 the amount of low-interest loans we were going to borrow from the MWRA. As I should have known and had always done before that, town meeting must also authorize the grant funding. Even though it's not a financial issue to the town, we still need permission to accept money from the MWRA. So town meeting is requested to make a revised motion that will incorporate in phase 9 and phase 10 the total of $1,688,000, which includes all the grant money and all the low interest loan money. Prior town meeting only approved the $422,000 of low interest loans.
FinCom report, Mr. McNeese.
At our meeting on October 4th, the Finance Committee voted 8-0-0 in favor of the article.
Further discussion? None appearing, are we ready for the vote? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 10. Mr. Berman moves that we indefinitely postpone the substance of Article 10. Is there a second? Second. Any explanation?
I gave that previously. I don't believe I'll be standing in front of this town meeting or any other one asking for this, and if it's needed, it'll be a different town manager, I expect.
Okay. Any further discussion? None appearing. All those in favor of indefinite postponement, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And it is indefinitely postponed. Business under Article 11, Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. This is the part where we actually do spend money, including capital. So I'll go over them briefly. And again, I think there's only one change from the printed material. It's that sidewalk plow. This article reduces benefits by almost $200,000. You can see the reasons behind us. Health insurance premiums, when we build a budget, we don't exactly know what the health insurance rates are. We learn them generally in the middle to third week of February, which is a little late for the budget process. But in this case, the reduction in premiums is because we have an opt-out program where the town and the employees more or less share the cost of savings, 75% for the town, 25% for the employee. So if premiums are going to cost $5,000 and an employee opts out, has been in health insurance with the town for a prerequisite, a minimum of 2 years, has another plan, presumably through a spouse, that meets all the conditions that the federal government imposes, we actually pay them not to take health insurance through the town, and we pay them 25% of the savings, and we keep 75%. I don't like this morally, but it saved over $1 million over the last several years. So, you know, someday everyone else will pay everyone else not to do it, and we'll have a problem, but for now it's saving the town money. The capital, as we've already gone over, is $579,000. FinCom is asking to replenish a transfer they did for some ambulance and related equipment previously for $26,000. In the shorthand here, PC, is we have pay in class funding in the budget. We are only looking at this point to spend $11,000 of it for things that were already approved. We conducted a police assessment center, which is a part of the promotional process that was not anticipated when the budget was built. As you might guess, our wireless phone budget is also climbing at a rather fast rate. It's now above our actual phone budget, which is interesting. Public service wages, again, that's just an internal transfer of pay in class funding. As part of the promotion and turnover process, we had some new firefighters hired, and they require $10,000 of uniforms. Police are requesting vests and helmets for almost $10,000. and ambulance billing is probably underfunded by $3,000. And that last item particularly is really good news, because ambulance billing, excuse me, is a percent of our revenues. So on the revenue side, last I looked, our ambulance billing was around $800,000. It wasn't long ago that it was only $600,000. So that's a good expense to go up. Excuse me. In April of last spring, I stood in front of this body and told you there would be about a $100,000 increase in the rubbish disposal budget. We just did not have a signed contract, so I couldn't in good conscience ask for it. We did sign a 10-year contract. The out years are, I believe, a 2 to 2.5% more or less escalation from a base that's $100,000 higher than we budgeted. But I should also add that in prior years we had reduced rubbish expenses. We're very fortunate to have signed the contract when we did, because many other municipalities, including a couple of our neighbors, had a vendor just pull up and get out of the business. And there's lots of litigation going on. But the replacement cost for rubbish disposal has skyrocketed. Fortunately, we did not pick that vendor, and we have what is now a very good contract for 10 years. Even though they didn't pick up my trash today, Jeff. An item that is going to come back to town meeting in the future, perhaps as early as April, but possibly not, is a building security evaluation. We requested these funds in April town meeting. It is still ongoing. As you can imagine, when we get to the part of involving the elected boards, there will be an executive session because it's security. It's right now still at the staff level. We're just asking to reclassify this as capital. It looks better in a capital plan. You can keep track of what you're spending on your buildings, even though my initial reaction was to put it in as an expense. And then the two changes, excuse me, to the budget that have come up somewhat recently are $50,000 total, split into two parts, one for town buildings and one for schools. Now, keep in mind again, the facilities budget has three parts. It has town buildings, it has core facilities, and then the third piece is just part of the school budget. So it's part of the whole school budget. So this request is to put $10,000 more in the town buildings budget, which is a relatively small budget, less than $1 million, and $40,000 into the school budget. We rebid the cleaning services. We were very unsatisfied with a prior vendor, and the costs just went up. So the total is almost $490,000 of spending. The good news is there's $350,000 of that available naturally from what might be said recurring revenues, although with state aid you don't know. But there was a couple of extra $100,000 of new growth that will be part of the tax base next year. And with all this moving around and all the things I've described, we're only asking for $133,000 of free cash, which is rather low for a November town meeting. I mentioned earlier that we were increasing the capital line item in water, and this just shows you water is a bottom line budget. I technically don't have to show this to you, but it seemed like a reasonable thing to do to just show that debt service is going down and capital is going up. There's no net change.
FinCom report. Mr. McNeese.
At our meeting earlier this evening, the Finance Committee voted 9-0 in favor of the article.
Further discussion? None appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 12, Ms. Engstrom.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. The purpose of this article is to approve prior year bills. You'll notice that there are two bills listed, or two items listed on the slide. The first is for the MBTA. We have a licensing agreement with the MBTA that allows us to run a water main underneath the railroad tracks between Ash Street and Walker Brook Drive. And for some reason, the MBTA has failed to bill us for the last 5 years. So that's the first item you see there. And the second item is related to our gas bills for fiscal 13 for the school. What had happened there is Direct Energy was misapplying our payments to the wrong buildings, and so we were getting some overdue bills that didn't make sense to us because we'd already paid the bill, and it turned out they were applying the payments to the wrong bills, and so some of the smaller bills were actually showing credit balances. It took a long time to work this out with the vendor, but it ended up being that when there were credit balances, the secretaries, you know, didn't pay the monthly charges because they thought, I have a credit, but the credits were erroneous. So the 2400, 2068 you see there are those bills that were not paid because they were showing a credit balance for the month.
Income report, Mr. Burkhart.
At our meeting on October 4th, 2016, the Finance Committee recommended the subject matter of this article by a vote of 8-0-0.
Further discussion? None appearing. This requires a 9/10 vote. We're going to try a hand count first, and all those in favor, please raise your hand. And those opposed? And it carries unanimously. Business under Article 13. Mr. Clough. Mr. LaLasher?
Mr. Moderator, Articles 13 and 14 are requested to be postponed.
You're right. Excuse me. Mr. Halsey moves that we lay the substance of Article 13 on the table. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? Motion carries, and it is laid on the table. Mr. Halsey moves that we lay the substance of Article 14 on the table. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the substance of Article 14 is laid on the table. Business under Article 15, Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. It wouldn't be a town meeting if we didn't discuss Oakland Road, right, Bill? This is Mr. Brown's third attempt at getting this right, so hopefully we'll do it this time. The town, most recently in 2011, believed that they had done all the work necessary to clear the title, clear the land, and authorize the Board of Selectmen to sell the parcel on Oakland Road. Perhaps fortunately, the selectmen deferred a decision on that as the school committee and the school department worked on early educational space needs. Once that issue had been sidestepped and modular classrooms chosen, we came back to look at it and get it sold and get it completed. Since we had a new town council and we had found one or two inconsistencies in the past work, we asked them to look at it. And it turned out it was an enormous project. It required a lot of background, especially in the 1930s. My executive assistant spent hours reading through town meeting minutes typed up from the 1930s, and let me tell you, there's some pretty interesting things in there. There was goats and chickens. So there was quite a lot of background work that took a long time. Town Council believes we finally have it right. This article will clear, there's two articles, 15 and 16, that are necessary. This article will, if you will, clear the paper streets from the land. In 2011, there was a vote by town meeting on the principle of this, and it passed 94-12, but it unfortunately discontinued public ways, and these are private ways. Even though they are owned by the town, they are private ways. The action in 2011 was done with a town-generated map. Town Council, through some research, suggested a much better way to do it was something called the Chapman Park subdivision in 1911, which even predates our elder statesman in town meeting, barely. And he said this is the better foundation to build it on, is to make the motion refer to this document and this map rather than some town-generated conception of that. So Article 15, quite simply, discontinues the private ways as we once thought we had done.
All set. Is there further discussion? None appearing. We're ready for the vote. All those in favor, please raise your hand. And those opposed, motion carries.
Article 16 is the second and at least for now, the final step in this process. It actually authorized the Board of Selectmen to dispose of this land. This action was thought to be taken by a 2011 town meeting by a vote of 92-17. Town Council looked at that process and declared it insufficient, and I'll show you a map shortly on the next page. The Board of Selectmen and the School Committee have declared this land a surplus. So it is now clear for town meeting to take this action. And if I might just say a few words on behalf of the selectmen, sometime next spring when the budget is complete for FY18, and I don't know how fast after that, but at some point, the selectmen will use a public process to decide what to do with this land. We have pretty much 99% decided, maybe even 100, that the town itself has no use for it. That doesn't mean that there might be a related use that the town might participate in, but the odds are the selectmen will entertain any ideas for use of this property from a wide variety of users, invite the neighbors, invite the community in, listen to it, and come up with a process and a solution. It'll be very transparent. I don't think it'll take too long, but you know, it certainly could take 6 months to go through that process. This is the exact map that should be used in this article to authorize for disposal. I apologize, I know it's a little harder to read both in the warrant and behind me, but town council has excellent eyes and swears this is the right thing to do.
All set? Yep. Further discussion? Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Mario. Bill Brown, Precinct 8. 31 years and three town councils later, I think he's right. I'm only saying 99%. When the gavel comes down, we get the money, we'll do it. The two pieces of property that the school has turned over to the town, and that was a result of the Oakland Road being put in 1953, because those two pieces of property were originally given to the school committee in 1947, Article 22 of the town report. So, and honestly, I hope that the selectmen do not get too involved in the thing. I strongly suggest that you go out and hire a professional person, drop the gavel, and let's take the money. We have been, over the years, very, very poor negotiators of town property. And I can give you a litany of them, but I won't bore you with it tonight. But I ask you nicely, please, put it out, get a professional, let's get the highest price we can for it, and let's get it off on the tax rolls. And one other thing, I'm sure that somebody's going to get up here and say, we should save this land. Well, in 1946, it was scheduled, one of the many sites to be used for school. It was rejected. In the 50s, it was looked at for fire station. It was rejected. It has been suggested for library. That's been suggested. Imagination Station, conservation, just about every municipal use except for dog pound. And I probably would have been the first one in it. But it's been looked at every municipal possible use there is, and there is none. And it's been off the tax rolls since 1934. That's almost as old as I am. It's time to get it back on the tax rolls.
Further discussion? Yes, right here.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Will Finch, Precinct 8. As Bill Brown accurately predicted, will vote against this. I think it's a bad idea for the town to sell potential open space. We've got a lot of people in this town that are using open space, the town forest and Bear Meadow, and in much greater degree than has been in the past. So we certainly need open space for the passive recreation in this town. I will not vote for this article. Thank you.
Mr. Graham.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Russ Graham, Precinct 4. I will vote for it, but with the understanding that we have further discussion on it. I'd like to have a dollar for every hour that Mr. Brown and I have discussed Oakland Road over the years. But as the previous speaker said, this is the last remaining parcel of land in the middle of the town of Reading, directly adjacent to our major recreational area and to three schools. And I think we will rue the day that we do not have it. The Dividends Road area, which now has an elementary school sitting on it, was held prudently by the town for decades. And when we finally went to the State Department of Education, and they said, well, you know what the big problem is with all towns, we don't reimburse for land, and most of them don't have such land. Let me assure you, most of those communities had a lot more land than Reading does. And they could not believe the foresight, as they put it, of a community prudently holding on to land despite people anxiously wanting it, including the cemetery trustees. Probably a good place for a garage, I think. But at any rate, when that discussion comes up, I hope it's a long discussion, because I do believe it will rue the day, because we don't have much land left, folks.
Further discussion, Mr. LaLascia.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Just to be clear, should the town choose to sell this land, it is not obliged to take the highest bid. It does have leeway in what the use is and what the impact on the neighborhood would be.
Ms. Whiting.
Carolyn Whiting, Precinct 7. I'm also opposed to this because I know the land is very rocky and hilly, and I think that any kind of development on land like that would be likely to cause flooding in the basements of people who are downstream from there.
Further discussion? Yes.
Ann Landry, Precinct 5. As it's being transferred, the land would be transferred from the schools. I was hoping someone from the schools could just confirm that they don't see any use for it.
Do we have Ms. Borowski?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jean Borowski, Chair of the School Committee. The School Committee did vote unanimously to support this exact transfer. Our understanding is that this was actually intended to have happened at some point in the past, and this is more of a legality to catch the legal current situation up to how we thought it was a couple of years ago. So yes, as of this point, the School Committee is comfortable with this.
Further discussion? Yes.
Bob Connors, Precinct 4. I'm not too keen on this. It's a nice chunk of property. It's a big piece of property, and we're sort of cutting it loose without any idea what we want. I think we'd be better off deciding what the town wants. Do you want to open it up to development? Do you want to open it up to houses? Do you want to put a park there? And if we had a more solid idea of what we wanted to do with it, then we could make it surplus and go on with that plan. But right now, we just seem to be making it surplus and just, like I said, just cutting it loose to the winds, when I think we'd be much better off to spend some time deciding what we as a community would like to see happen with this piece of property. Thank you.
Further discussion? Mr. Brown?
Thank you, Ms. Moderator. Bill Brown, Precinct 8. The school apartments is probably 2,300 square feet. I once offered it to the former superintendent. I told him to put a platform so he could stand up and look over his domain. In response to the last gentleman, we've been looking at this since 1934. I know there's a shortage of playground space. I've got town reports 100 years said the same thing. We never have enough playroom space, we never have enough schools, and whatever. But I think it's time to get it back on the tax rolls. Thank you very much.
Further discussion? Yes.
Linda Snow Doxer, 110 Beaver Road, Reading. I just had a question. I know that Mr. LaLascia said that we would have some control over what that land was used for, especially with the passage of question 4. I was just wondering, if the land changes hands and then it's sold again, do we still have that control over what that land is used for? Thank you.
Mr. Meares.
Good evening.
The answer to the question is, assuming you get good legal work. So if the property is offered for sale, it will be pursuant to an RFP that will contain whatever conditions the town decides it needs. Those conditions will then be incorporated into the deed, and then they will run with the land, assuming you have good legal work.
Further discussion? Not appearing. Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the chair is in doubt. Can I ask my counters to count? All those in favor, please rise. This requires a two-thirds vote, by the way.
18. 25.
18 and 25?
25.
15.
15. And who am I missing? Oh.
27.
27. And those opposed? Twelve.
15.
15. 14.
14.
14. The vote being 85 in the affirmative, 55 in the negative, it does not reach the two-thirds, so it fails. Business under Article 17, Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. If I might just take a quick overview of the upcoming general bylaws. Article 17, which we'll do shortly, is a very quick one that allows non-substantive alphanumeric changes. This is something we tried to do as part of the charter, and the Attorney General scolded us and said it belongs in a bylaw. Article 18 is caused by new legislation that I'll review. Mr. Moderator, if I might, Articles 19 and 23 are better handled on Thursday. They're both stormwater related. Article 20 establishes the Department of Public Works, even though we all know it exists. It was taken out of the charter, and this is, if you will, charter follow-up. Article 21 allows repairs on private ways. This is something suggested by council when learning that we were doing it. And then Article 22 establishes formally the stormwater utility, which all it really does is codify into a bylaw the current practice. And also a correction from the printed material. The bylaw committee votes were unanimous, but there were only three members present. I had inaccurately put 4-0. They were votes as 3-0. So for Article 17, again, this is really quite simple. It just adds the words alpha and removes an archaic reference to the code. And for those folks that were on the charter review committee, we could never quite figure out what the code was, but it sounded kind of intriguing. But in any event, we couldn't find it, so we should remove it. And again, this is just a simple thing that was proposed as part of the charter, so that if, for instance, someone has made either an alpha or numeric error in numbering or in spelling, the town clerk, with the approval of the bylaw committee, may make a change.
Bylaw committee report, do we have one on that? Hey, Mr. Struble?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. At our meeting on September 14th, we voted to support this article by a vote of 3-0-0.
0-0. Further discussion? Yes. Mr. O'Rourke?
Tom O'Rourke, Precinct 2. Mr. Moderator, I think the second last line, removers, should be removes, just a typographical error.
I see what you mean, removes?
It's removes.
Okay, we're going to accept that as part of the main motion, unless there's any objection.
I think the motion itself is fine. That's just the presentation.
Oh, okay, good enough. All right, further discussion? None appearing. Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor, please raise your hand. And those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 18, Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. This may be one of my all-time favorite articles in front of town meeting. There was some legislation that our House and Senate and the governor ultimately signed this summer, late this summer, called Municipal Modernization. It's a very thick docket. There's several good ideas in there. There's some ideas that don't apply to Reading. They're really more urban. This is not one of those good ideas. This requires the town to put these revolving funds that you approve annually as part of the annual town meeting into a bylaw. It does not relieve you of the responsibility to continue to approve them annually. So you will still do that, and you will now need to have them in a bylaw. It further hampers you that if we wanted to make any change, instead of doing it at annual town meeting, we would have to go through a bylaw process. So I'm not quite sure, this certainly is municipal, I'm not quite sure I see the modernization in this part, but I don't know the practices of other cities and towns, so this is probably some sort of a control element on all the rogue towns out there. This is not something that is going to improve town government, though. It's just another layer that'll cause us to go through a bylaw process if we need to.
Okay. You all set? Okay. Bylaw Committee report. Mr. Struble.
At our meeting on September 14th, we voted to recommend this article by a vote of 3-0-0.
Is there further discussion? Not appearing. We're ready for the vote. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, and the motion carries. Mr. Lash, did you say earlier we were not ready to go ahead with 19?
I could request that 19 be postponed to Thursday.
Okay, Mr. Halsey moved that we lay Article 19 on the table. Is there a second? Second, all those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, motion carries. Article 19 is laid on the table. Business under Article 20, Mr. LaLasher.
Those of the Charter Committee members will recognize that as part of the Charter, a transitional language was removed from the Charter, and a big portion of the transitional language was because the Public Works Department used to be under the auspices of an elected board, and that elected board, I assume, negotiated or required the old Charter to have language in the Charter that made sure we kept the DPW and what the rules would be. As no other department was in the Charter in quite that fashion, it seemed to the Charter Committee, and certainly for what it's worth, I agreed to take it out of the Charter. However, Town Council, as part of the cleanup, has always had this on a list that once we get around to, you know, doing some bylaw work, it's a good idea to define what the Public Works Department is. So virtually, the language from the Charter is almost verbatim and now put into a bylaw. I think the only changes were typographical and some revisions to what we call things now, but otherwise the intent was identical to what the Charter described. And Council was just concerned that if there were ever a legal reason why DPW would need to have a legal foundation, it didn't. Now it does. It doesn't change the operation of the department. It doesn't change the budgeting practice. It just gives the department legal foundation in a bylaw.
Bylaw Committee report, Mr. Struble.
The Bylaw Committee voted to recommend this article 3-0-0 at our September 14th meeting.
Thank you. Further discussion? Not appearing. All those in favor of the article, please raise your hand. Those opposed, and the motion carries. Business under Article 21.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Upon learning some of the town practices, Town Council has sometimes exclaimed, oh my, and this was one of them. The town on occasion does repair work to private ways. That's understandable when we need to be able to run an ambulance or a public safety equipment down a private road. It needs to be kept in a condition so that that can safely happen purely from a public safety standpoint. So that this is a whole new bylaw. This does not exist. It did not exist in the Charter. This is a whole new concept. This is to allow the town legally to go in and make repairs on a private way. Technically speaking, now when the town goes in and does work, it does not have as sound a legal footing as it should. to make those repairs. So if you look at 8.5.3.1, there's a specific list of the type of work that the town anticipates doing on a private way. And again, this repair work is more or less classified as emergency. It's not cosmetic. It's things that really need to happen in order for the road to be safe. And if you can see, it's highlighted by that last bullet point. Any other temporary repair deemed necessary to protect public safety. It also authorizes the DPW, I believe with the town manager's permission, to make non-emergency minor repairs at its own cost, if we so choose. And again, that would be at the discretion of the DPW and the town manager. Town meeting does approve funding every year for road work. I don't think we'd spend much in a private way, but you never know, there certainly could be patching. And there's money in the operating budget for DPW for potholes and patching. It's theoretically possible that the DPW may request and the town manager may approve spending the minor amounts, which are not defined, by the way. As is the case, right now, if you own a private way, and I have to admit I own a house that's on a private way, so I have to be careful, there is a method for petitioning to the town to make it public, and this body has seen examples of that. This is an ability to petition the town to make a repair without going through the process to make it a public road. So if there were a dozen owners of a private way and they wish to make the road public, the board would require them to petition and generally requires a near unanimous consent of the owners to bring the road up to what the town would call its standards. Usually that involves hundreds of thousands of dollars of work if it's 10 people. Those 10 people then by frontage pay the costs of that. Some of them may pay it in a lump sum. Some may choose to pay a certain interest rate set by the state and pay it as part of their tax bill over up to 20 years. And at that point, the road is public. The town takes over. This bylaw would allow the same residents to just request a repair that they would choose, not the town. The town may say, our standard is, sidewalks and this much width. Private road owners may not want sidewalks and may not have the width without giving frontage of their property, but they may still choose to ask the town to pave the road. Generally speaking, from the experience I've heard from other residents, the town generally gets a good price to pave things. So this is an ability for those owners to request that the town make a repair and agree to pay for it without the road becoming public. And again, such a request would go through a typical hearing process, just like becoming a public road would, except it doesn't go through town meeting. There's some language in here about who pays, and again, the town may, at its option, pay. The residents may request a repair that the town would not agree to pay, and they may agree to pay. And I think the last important point, well, I suppose the last two, 8539. If the town does make a repair to a private way, is not to be construed that the town has taken it over as public. So again, if private owners wanted to make it public and to remove their responsibility forever, the town would have a certain requirement of what that would mean. Presumably, there could be repairs made, and in fact, I know there will be, for a much lower standard, and we just want to make sure the bylaw protects the town. Just because that repair happened does not mean it's now a public road. In order for that to happen, a higher level of repair would be needed. And then lastly, just a typical liability clause, as is the case now on our public ways, although I don't remember the dollar amounts. So again, the spirit of this is to protect the town's interest and to allow private owners to have a little bit more leeway, I guess, if you will, in doing repairs that are needed. And the town does require owners of private roads to to keep the roads in a certain minimal condition. I don't know, I can't speak for all the private roads, but I'm sure there's a difference of how some of the private roads are kept, some in good quality, some in not so good quality. But the main purpose of the beginning of this bylaw is to make sure an emergency vehicle can get down. And as you can imagine, it would have to be an incredibly poor condition road for that to be a question.
Bylaw Committee report, Mr. Struble.
The Bylaw Committee voted to recommend this article by a vote of 300 at our September 14th meeting.
Is there further discussion? Yes, Ms. Webb.
Elaine Webb, Precinct 1. I just had a question about how much money the town is spends now, maybe on average, on these emergency type minor repairs to the private ways.
How much money does the town currently spend to make private ways passable for public safety? I'd have to say it was nominal.
Yes. Mr. Herrick.
Steve Herrick, Precinct 8. The petition section, this is really just a clarity question. I'm just trying to understand here. It sounded when we were discussing this like the petition was for the homeowners to come to the town and say, hey, can you patch up our road? But when I read this, it says, except as provided in 8, it says, except as provided in section 8532, the town may make temporary repairs to eligible private ways only if CPDC, Director of Public Works, and the record of owners of at least 2/3 of the lots abutting the portion of the private way repaired have assented. So it seems to me that this is really saying what I'm reading here, but I'm not the lawyer down there. It sounds to me like this is saying the town can only go in and make those repairs if 2/3 of the people assent. And it doesn't really address the people coming to the town and saying, hey, can you patch my potholes? Am I getting that backwards? I'm not understanding, because it seemed different.
You're reading the way it's written, but I would assume as a matter of course that it would be the residents upon learning of the opportunity to request it. Just so you know, I can see town council warming up in the bullpen back there, but right now, to speak broadly for the Board of Selectmen in this circumstance, to make a road public is a very high hurdle. Somewhere about 90% of the residents must agree to bear the cost. This does lower the bar to 2/3, and I'll defer to council on the rest.
Mr. Meharis.
So there are two bullets in 8.5.3.3 regarding the petition. The first bullet is a petition that's initiated by the CPDC or the Director of Public Works and has the assent of 2/3 of the abutting property owners. The second bullet is a petition initiated by the property owners. So it can be done either way. Either the town determines that it really needs to be done and gets the assent of the property owners, or the property owners themselves initiate the petition.
So am I reading it correctly on the first bullet that if 2/3 of the owners say, we don't want you touching our road, that the town can't do anything?
That's correct. Well, this requires both the CPDC or the Director of Public Works to initiate it and
right,
get 2/3 assent.
Precisely. So they come in and say, hey, your road needs work. And right. Then the town, the people on the road say, nah, we're good. We don't want to pay for it, and it's fine the way it is. Does that tie the town's hands for safety purposes here?
It does indeed.
Is that the way this was intended to be written? I don't know. Put it together.
If it goes to the level of minor repair, we can do it without a petition, but no major overhauls of roads. So patching potholes and whatever to make it passable can be done as a minor repair with the approval of the town manager.
And that's the stuff that the town would pay for, but at some point it elevates to the, we're going to hit with a bill.
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Further discussion? Mr. Brown.
Bill Brown, Precinct 8. I'd like to offer a friendly amendment on the last bullet, Bob, on 8.5.3.1. says any other temporary repair deemed necessary, I'd like to put in the words, or work necessary to protect public service, public safety.
So after repair?
Yes.
Is there a second? Second, Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I came home one day, and one of the neighbors across the street, there was a tree across their private way. I don't consider that a repair, but they came in for public safety reasons to remove the tree. So I think it covers that, and it certainly doesn't take, you know, a lot of work. Thank you.
Okay. Any further discussion on that amendment? None appearing. We'll vote on the amendment right now. All those in favor of the proposed amendment, please raise your hand. Those opposed, and the motion carries. Now back to the main motion. We had a hand. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Tony DeRezzo, Precinct 2. I'd like to offer two amendments.
We'll take them one at a time.
All right. The first is in Section 8.5.3.3. I would like to change both occurrences of the phrase two-thirds to be nine-tenths.
Is it down in the last bullet? Oh, okay. Okay, is there a second? Second, Mr. Perezzo.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. The reason for this is my concern is that if you have a private way and a developer comes in at the end of the way and subdivides many lots, the local residents may lose control to the developer. If you have four units or four lots on a private way and a developer puts in, say, six or seven units, he instantly has two-thirds and has an overriding majority and can then force the residents to pay for the repairs.
Is there further discussion on the proposed amendment? None appearing. All those in favor of the proposed amendment, please raise your hand. Those opposed, and the motion does not carry. Did you have a second amendment, or was that the both?
I had a second amendment.
Okay,
Mr.
we'll take
Chairman.
It now.
In Section 8.5.3.6, you have at the bottom, it says, the repair costs shall be with all such owners sharing equally. There's no reference there. Oh, excuse me. I would like to change that to sharing proportionally based on frontage.
Okay, is there a second? Second. Mr. Perezzo?
As it was written and as I had read it, it implied that no matter how much your frontage may be, you are sharing the same cost. If you had 1,000 feet of frontage and someone else had 10 feet, you would both be paying the same amount.
Okay, further discussion on the proposed amendment? Yes, Mr. Arena?
John Arena, Precinct 1. Just in response to that last proposed amendment, I've got to believe that the intent of equal was to address the case where the repair is to a common area rather than to the immediate area of an individual. Obviously, the repair will be closer to some than others, but so that there isn't the argument over I benefit more, I benefit less, I've got to believe the equally clause was to take it out of the realm of who's improved and who isn't. Who owns a pothole? Who owns a crack? Who owns a stuck catch basin? It's for the benefit of the immediate community. I think that's the intent, so it doesn't go to the debate of, well, I'm going to have to pay more than you because I have more frontage. It doesn't hurt me that much. It's still a public safety issue. It takes it out of that realm and more into let's do what's practical, not let's do what's economic.
Further discussion on the amendment, proposed amendment. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Tony DiRezzo, Precinct 2. I would agree with Mr. Arena if the line above there did not refer to the owners of all lots abutting the portion of the private way to be repaired. It's saying the portion of the private way to be repaired, which would cover whatever section that may have, and it wouldn't be a pothole, it would be a significant repair, replaced. So if three houses abutted a section of the road that was replaced and the other five or six did not abut, those three houses would share, I would assume, equally, no matter how much frontage they may have. And I just wanted to make it clear that it would be based on some sort of proportion. Thank you.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment? Not appearing. All those in favor of the proposed amendment, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion does not carry. Now we're back into the main motion again. Further discussion? None appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand. And those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 2, Mr. LaLazier.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. This is another, I guess I'll call it a housekeeping issue suggested by council that, well, we have a stormwater enterprise fund and it seems to be working as intended. We really should codify with a bylaw what those are. We stood in front of town meeting several years ago and explained how we are going to run the fund, and indeed that's how it's run. We have a certain way to price the costs. We have a certain way to operate it. But that was just our word at the time that that's what we would do. This actually puts it in writing and lets everyone see it. So it doesn't change what the town is doing, but it makes the town continue to do it in the future the way it was described in the past.
Bylaw Committee report, Mr. Struble.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. The Bylaw Committee voted to recommend this Article 300 at our September 14th meeting.
Further discussion? Mr. Brown.
Excuse me, Bob. Mr. Manager, you say fee. I suggest it is a tax and not a fee.
Further discussion? Not appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Oh, I'm sorry. Excuse me. I'm sorry. There was a hand. Did I miss one? I still don't see it. Oh, I'm sorry. Ms. Snyder.
Gina Snyder, Precinct 5. I wanted to clarify if the, I always thought the stormwater utility had to do with the MS4 permit and compliance with preventing pollution to waters of the U.S. But at the last town meeting, I think some reference was made to spending the money on flood projects. So I wanted to confirm that it's actually to assure pollution is kept out of waters.
Mr. LaLazier.
Thank you. I can start to answer the question. We have some DPW folks when I slip up. The explanation to town meeting at the time was very much with that permit in mind, that we didn't know what it was going to look like, we didn't know what obligations we would have, and we didn't have a mechanism to pay for them. But in addition, it was to do other stormwater improvements as the town deemed fit that it could not do now and could not afford to do now. So there are definitely things done currently in the stormwater fund to just repair drainage projects that have nothing to do with that permit. They're to prevent people's yards and homes from flooding. So there are both reasons is why that fund started. It was to do stormwater related activities the town had not previously been able to afford to do as part of its general fund budget. And both those parts, and I don't know, are there other parts? I think that pretty much covers it. And I still think by the permit, we don't have a clear direction of all the responsibilities the town will have. That's evolving.
Well, I'm almost starting to agree with Mr. Brown, if that's how it's being used. So I'd like to express my concern, but I'm not going to try to make an amendment. Thank you.
Further discussion? Those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 23, Mr. Brown. Mr. LaLasher.
I'd like to also continue that. If I might request that also be delayed till Thursday.
Okay. As Mr. Halsey moves that we lay the substance of Article 23 on the table, is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? Motion carries, and it's laid on the table. Okay, CPDC is not prepared to start zoning, so Mr. Halsey moves that we adjourn this town meeting until Thursday, November 17th. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please signify by raising your hand. Those opposed? Motion carries. This town meeting stands adjourned until Thursday, November 17th.